Okay, good afternoon, everyone. Thank you so much for joining for this very interesting and I'm sure delightful webinar session that is going to be hosted by Aurora University and School of Hospitality Management. I am joined by my colleague, Chef Jignesh Mistry from our school. And we also have members from our Aurora University team supporting us in conducting this webinar. We have Mrs. Shreya Mathur, we have Mr. Manish from the IT team, we have Ms. Penal from the registrar's office, and other members that are present here. We also are very privileged and honored to have a very good panel chefs, and also, should I say, our alumni students from Aurora University joining us this afternoon. I'm very happy and privileged to welcome Chef Mansi Katlawala, batch 2011-2015 pass out student, and then we have Chef Arusha Relin, batch 2017 student, now working and running a very successful business in Surat, which I'll be introducing you to in a minute. And lastly but not least, we have Chef Komal Patel also joining us in this webinar and sharing her insights and experiences of running a business or bakery venture from home. We really welcome you all and really thankful for you to share spare your time and spend some and have a very meaningful discussion about bakery products, running a bakery business. And I think working from home is the most fashionable thing nowadays. So I think baking from home has always been in presence, but I think will be more in vogue and more in demand as the time progresses and the demand really comes from the market. So I think capitalizing on that, we will have a meaningful discussion today. But before I start with the session, let me just introduce and give you a little brief about the Aurora University and the school that we represent. I would like to give you a brief introduction about Aurora. Established in the year 2011, Aurora is registered under the Gujarat Private Universities Act and under UGC Act. At Aurora, we believe in integral and transformational learning, a platform given to the students to embark on the journey from learners to leaders. The learning at Aurora is not just confined to four walls classroom, and it goes much beyond it. There are total 8 schools at Aurora University delivering exceptional teaching and learning to all its stakeholders. So we have School of Business, School of Hospitality Management, under whose aegis this webinar is being organized, School of Information Technology, School of Law, School of Journalism and Mass Communication, School of Liberal Arts, and School of Sciences, which we'll be introducing from this year. Under School of Hospitality Management, we currently have 5 programs offered at different levels. At undergraduate level, we have BSc Honours in Hospitality Management. We also have an integrated BSc MSc Honours Hospitality Management program. Then at Master's level, we have an MSc Hospitality Management program. And PG level programs, PG Diploma in Event Management, which we provide in collaboration with our partner Viscraft Mind from Mumbai. And we also have a postgraduate diploma in Contemporary Bakery and Patisserie, and that is very much relevant to the topic we're going to be discussing. Before I get on to the topic and have a very interesting and meaningful discussion with all our panelists, let me just introduce them to you. I will start with Chef Mansi Katlawala. Please welcome Chef Mansi. She is a pastry chef who operates from home under the label The Pastries Palette. Her passion is to make people move away from stereotypical combinations, dessert choices, and show them the beauty of fusing the simplest along with the most exotic ingredients. Apart from baking, she enjoys food styling and photography. We can safely say that her life revolves around food. The next person that I'm going to introduce is Chef Arusha Relin. Please welcome Chef Arusha Relin, founder of Let's Whisk and Bakery Company. Besides baking and cooking, Arusha is a fun-loving food enthusiast. She loves to experiment and recreate international recipes. The credit of offering artisan desserts to Surat city very much goes to her. And lastly, we have Chef Komal Patel. Please welcome to the webinar. She's founder of Cake Nest. She likes to explore and create new 3D cakes. We will also be sharing some images and some creations some pictures of the creations that these people have made in the past, which makes her product different from the others. Apart from home baking, she manages her family business, which is Hotel Casa Riva near Bhata, near Oru University, where she also manages the restaurant operations. On that note, I really welcome you and thank you from the bottom of my heart for taking your time out and participating in this webinar. And I hope you will really be able to contribute and probably deal with some of the issues that we are facing. And also open a new career opportunity for people or youngsters who may be willing or, you know, who may be joining or who must be participating in this industry right now. Let me tell you, we have more than around 150 participants, and I think we'll be joined by more. There will be more attendees on the Facebook channel also. So I think we really have a good coverage for this webinar. And on that note, I will just begin this session without any further ado. Let me just start with a very, very typical and cliche question, I think, which many of the people nowadays ask, and the fun of asking that: what is your daily routine nowadays during this pandemic? And how have you kept yourself busy, energized, and definitely motivated during this lockdown, which has been, you know, ever stretching? So I'll start with Mansi, and then probably Arusha can speak, and then Chef Komal can speak here. So Chef,
thank you very much, Vimal sir. Thank you for that warm welcome. You asked a very interesting question. Lockdown. I think lockdown is going to produce more chefs than ever. People have gotten to baking, developing new recipes, all of that, because you have the time in hand, right? So I would just say that I have a rapid increase in house chores due to lockdown. And apart from that, I have really got the time to develop a really good fitness routine. Because first, like, you know, I cannot stress enough on how important it is in a profession like ours. You're standing like 12 to 13 hours a day. So, you know, a good fitness routine is something you have to develop. Otherwise, you cannot function. That's like number one. Other than that, I try to, develop and perfect at least 4 to 5 recipes a week, because that doesn't, you know, my normal routine would not give me this kind of time to actually be at peace, work on something that I love. So I think that's actually a blessing in disguise. And more than that, I think meditation also. So a lot of things that I couldn't do in my normal this thing is happening due to lockdown. So I'm kind of really happy with it. A baker is anyways comfortable at home, so it does not matter too much. Vimal sir, I think you're not audible.
Okay. Yes, thank you. Thank you, Mansi. Yes,
Arusha,
please.
Yeah, so as Mansi mentioned, like everyone, like every person now has to become a baker. So it's like you see, if you go on social media, someone or the other is either baking or cooking. Yeah, but it's like, as she mentioned, now we have a window to experiment new things. And, you know, even we have guinea pigs at home and people are like expecting, oh, we are craving something sweet. And moreover, people are more trusting you right now in case of hygiene and everything, because they somewhere in their mind, like, I live in a society. So this is an advantage. Like, if they can't move out of the house, so I have people coming to me, oh, can you make this? Oh, can you make that? You know, just get into the market and serving people around. And like, quarantine is helping to like standardize my recipe or make new recipe or just work on existing ones. And you know, it's a time period where you can do any and everything in spite of having limited ingredients. But yeah, that is also a task was helping. And you know, just in case in future same thing happens, we at least have something creative on the board to serve people around.
Thank you, thank you. And now I just call upon Chef Komal to give her comments.
I am with Arusha and Mansi that everyone is becoming baker and everyone is stuck with their housework. But personally for me, I am very grateful that I have this pandemic time, because I got time for myself, and I always wanted to have my own journal regarding my own cake designs, and I actually got time, a quality time for that. And I really take that time positively and create my own journal. And I work on my flaws, which actually help me in my future with my cake business.
Okay, thank you. So before we move on and get to know and start talking about bakery and other such things, I would just like to rewind and go back a little bit and talk about your passing out years. I think it will be different for all three of you. So what has been your journey post Oro University when you passed out, and what have you all done? What are the qualifications that you have gathered, and how have you really mastered this art of baking and patisserie?
Post Oro, so we already had a basic idea and knowledge about the hospitality industry, right? But you cannot be sure completely, like right out of college, there are 100 things that you can do. And I always wanted to get into something related to culinary. Being a vegetarian, it's a big challenge to, you know, not work with meats, not work with, you know, a lot of ingredients that involve animal fat or things like that. So but I didn't want to give up on the entire side of culinary. So then I tried to let it go. I tried to work in travel and tourism for a bit, but then I got back to baking. Like, you know, it had to be something related to food. That was it for me. So I found this course in Bangalore, and I pursued a diploma in baking science and pastry arts from L1. It was really hands-on, and after that I've interned at a lot of places. I interned in Mumbai with a really renowned vegan baker. So as we all know that, you know, these are the trends that are picking up right now. Nobody is restricted to conventional baking now. People want new things all the time. Being from Gujarat also, you know, I was mocked up in my pastry school for asking egg alternatives for everything. Like, I'd ask, what's the replacement for this? And they'd be like, are you from Gujarat? That's the major, you know, conception about everything. And it's true, our market does demand that. So I've been working on those. I've been working on a lot of own recipes, replacing a lot of things, coming up with egg substitutes and vegan and, you know, guilt-free baking, because that's what even I as a fitness enthusiast promote. So that's kind of something that you would see in my work too. So that's all I've been baking. And, you know, Pastori's Palette is a 2-year young venture now. So yeah, that's about
it. Okay, Arusha, over to you.
Yeah, so initially when I was on my internship, as a part of my bachelor's, I always wanted to have a sweet little place where it serves like just dessert. I was always into culinary, like especially into Indian cooking. But then somewhere in my heart, I always wanted to work with desserts. And as soon as I completed my graduation, I was in a question, what to do next? Even though, like, as a part of our academics, we have to make a plan, like entrepreneurship was a module that we had, so I still had a clear picture and I still worked on my dessert thing. So still I used to sit and question my dad, like what to do next and everything. I even went to consultant, but somewhere in my heart I knew I have to learn, I have to have hands-on experience and everything for what I have to do. Like, if I have to open up a dessert shop, I need to know what desserts I should have. I can hire a chef, but then still I need to know what actually it is, what classically it is. So after a year or like 8-9 months of break, I went to Le Cordon Bleu, Melbourne, to pursue my advanced diploma in pastry. I did my internship in Mumbai, Taj Lands End, and I just, to be frank, I just had to leave it halfway because I felt I can do, I always wanted to be an independent baker and just not go with the flow. So I chose to come back and I started as a home baker. So initially my first product was displayed at an exhibition. This is how I started, and then was still fighting with the name. I got one name and then that was already registered by someone else and had to fight and everything. Like, getting a name was also a thing. Like, I need to have a name which people can, you know, remember easily. So if you are good with products and people are like very much confused with your name, they would, you know, just skip. So yeah, like how my journey started. And as Mansi mentioned about the egg thing, so it was same like abroad, egg is like vegetarian. So yeah, if you ask them what are the substitute, they are like, seriously? So yeah, but still, if you have to end up where you are staying, you need to work on it. So even I had to like almost work on all my recipes to have substitute for eggs, or how the market is, what they are demanding. So I have few things on my menu like macaroons where I personally don't feel like replacing egg because it spoils the taste, even though there are people selling eggless macaroons, but I don't think they are actually up
they're
to the
mark. Actually macaroons.
Yeah, actually.
You can't call them macaroons.
So yeah, it's like for me, in example of macaroons, like initially when I started, I had people like very good market for macaroons, and then people I had who were like, do you make eggless macaroons? I'm like, no, because somewhere in my heart I thought it's okay, I can say no to two people, but I don't want to like just
compromise
yeah, because eight people are eating anyways, and I think people are now accepting eating eggs in desserts and everything, but still there are people who are not. But yeah, it's a very big, huge task. Even though if you study, you need to know what are the substitute and how they work technically even.
Yeah.
Thank you so much, Arusha. Komal, your comments, please.
Well, when I started my journey with Oro, I always knew that I wanted to do something related with the colors and artwork. And I knew that event management is something very perfect, which I wanted to have. But when I started my journey and when I went on my internship, I worked in a bakery, and by that time I was very clear that creating a cake which is very more creative and very handful job, you know, it's like it's a very hard and it's a very patientful job, but and then I really wanted to do that, and I would say thanks to Oro that they gave us opportunity to go abroad, and by that time only I was very clear that I wanted to baker, and after my graduation I started learning bakery, and I learned in Surat only, and then I realized that whether we study abroad or in India, we have to get a good mentor to learn everything from basics. And thanks to my ma'am, that where I am right now, I'm very grateful to her that whatever I'm achieving right now is because of her, and I'm very happy wherever am I.
Thank you so much, Komal. Thank you. So, you know, just to sum up what you all have said is, I think one thing that you really, all three of you have emphasized is, there is some level of technical training, which is very, very important.
Yeah.
Interest is very essential. Yes. Of course, that's the essential ingredient. But to build on the interest and the passion and put it together to be able to sell it like a product in the market, some technical hand-holding, like Kashyap Komal has said, or some training is essential. So that is very, very right by all three of you. And also taking one step ahead, how Arusha has also talked about, you know, this is my next question, at what point did you all decide to convert your interest or your passion of baking into a serious business venture? You know, the next big step of making it an entrepreneurial subject, or, you know, becoming an entrepreneur and deciding it to start from home, how did this all come together? Okay. So I will again start with Mansi in that flow.
That's a really good question, Vimal sir. See, nobody is always clear that this is how I'm going to begin. So you have a lot of models in your head that initially everybody starts with like, oh, I'm going to have a restaurant or cafe of my own. Oh, I'm going to do this, or I'm going to do that. But for me, the first question that I ask myself is that, do I have so much talent to be able to justify what I'm going to give on the plate, right? I cannot directly wake up, come out of college and start a restaurant. That's something that I personally don't feel is justified. So I thought about different ways as to how I could, you know, work on myself, do something better, and still be in touch with the market. So I was talking to a lot of people, and when I did my pastry course also, I discussed it with my chefs also over there. And I really asked that people initially used to look down upon home baking. Like, you know, it's a thing which everybody does. Oh, somebody learns something on YouTube and starts doing it. But I thought, no, we can do it. This can be done in a different way. So what I did was I perfected some recipes, a lot of trials, a lot of things. I decided that this is how I want to go about. I would, you know, sample it to a few of my friends, see, get initial, you know, good, honest criticism. I've got a lot of criticism. The first cake that I gave it to my friend was completely hard. She couldn't eat it. It was inedible. But, you know, that happens with everybody. So I decided to try it out, and that is the first method that I took good month and a half to introduce, float it around as to how I'm getting the responses, work upon it, and then I started accepting orders. And I would only accept things that I could work with, things that I could deliver as promised, so that whatever I'm giving is in line with what I'm promising. So this was my goal that, you know, first let me introduce it from the home itself, and then maybe, you know, go further. There are a lot of things that I have in the pipeline, but this was my first step, and touch wood, we've been getting great responses, and I think it's the best way to learn. Because you don't have a lot of responsibility in this phase. So yeah. I think, yeah, that was about how I made this choice. So I'll hand it over to you, Arusha.
Yeah, so I totally agree with Mansi. Like, it's just, you never know what you want, but somewhere in my heart, I knew I want to be at a place where I'm making desserts. And then comes a point where you even have to, you just can't say, I want to do this, but people are not accepting you into the market. So if you think in Surat, where can you go to have a dessert, like classic dessert? I'll tell you panna cotta, you'll have to think. But yeah. Somewhere you have to like even see if you open up a place where you're serving all this, you'll have very limited footfalls. So to be frank, when I literally went into the market, I had like all signature desserts like baked yogurt, baked cheesecake, macaroons, everything. But still, at a point to get more footfalls and more people to my place, I had to, anyways, had to get to the basic and get pastries into the stall. So people, you know, at least if they come to buy a pastry, they see. If they don't see, they'll come at least, and salesman would just, you know, ask, you can taste this, this is what's new. So somewhere I feel your goal and your market where you are, it has to go parallel. Because if you have a great dream in your brains, but then you have people who are not accepting it, is also a big, very big task, like, which personally I suffered, because I am more into desserts than into cakes. Like Bansi yeah. and Komal would have different perspective, but in yeah. my case also, like, even I think for Mansi, she is into, like, she's not into fondant cakes, yeah. but she is, but still I think people would still go and ask her, oh, can you make this, can you make that? And at a point, you are in a situation where customer is trusting you enough, so they keep requesting you, oh, please, can you yeah. do it? But they forget, like, we can't sometimes just express or tell them, like, this is not we do, and this is what we can't. It doesn't mean that if you are good at desserts, you would be good at something else as well. Because you are into that current situation because of what you are right now. So I'm sure me and Mansi, like, we have discussed already before yeah. on this topic, like, people are expecting huge cakes, but then they don't really understand how it is working right now.
Yes, Komal, please, over to you.
Yeah, so as I said earlier, that I was very clear after my internship that I wanted to be a baker, but after my graduation, I was very confused whether I should go with the shop or I would do home baking. And then I realized that baking and baking a cake is something, you know, you really have to have a lots and lots of practice. Otherwise, you won't have a perfect cake. So then I thought, and then I realized that I should go with the home baking because it is a less expensive and a less investing business. And I think whether I do my business from home or from shop, product is something that will speak for my brand. So I thought that product is something that I wanted to highlight, and then my branding, because if my product is good, then my branding is I don't have to work with my brand, because people will know me with my product and with my brand name. So I started with the home baking. Earlier I had disaster, like Mansa said, and if I tell you my first experience, it was like I made a white ganache cake, and it was totally disaster, and it was not appealing. But then when I took classes, even though after classes I had a few disasters, but by practicing it, I become a good baker, and I would say touch wood that I'm doing good right now. And I would suggest that if anybody wants to do something relating to bakers, just make sure that always you have practice and practice, then only you can do better and better. There is no shortcut of doing it, or you can't just learn from YouTube, because it is something that will seek for your attention, patience, hygiene and everything.
Very, very rightly put, Komal. And I will ask you a question in regard to this very clearly. Since we have all started successful ventures, and I think, Mansi, your venture has now become 2 years old, and Arusha's and Komal is probably a little younger than that.
Yeah.
So my question is, how do you start? What are the advantages that you look at, starting your own baking venture? And what are the advantages? Why should people go into this? You know, because there would be many options that you would normally face. Like, working for somebody else or working for a hotel or a restaurant or anything else. But when you decide to work from home and create bakery creations, cakes or desserts or whatever, and sell it to the market, what are the advantages that you get as a professional baker? What are the advantages? Yes, Mansi, over to you.
Okay. So, like I said, the sole reason why I chose this kind of a model to begin was, you have sort of a safety net when you start baking at home. You know, you always, if you're not able to manage something, you can count upon your parents, your family, somebody to run around and just help you finish that job. I would call it spoon feeding for at least the first month, because you don't have that experience. You don't know how much inventory you require. You don't know how much is gonna go in that particular thing. You're gonna mess something up. You're going to have to recreate it. You have a lot of things. So if you're making it from home, you have that safety net. You have that additional help. So I think that's a really good way to go about if you're new at this. Secondly, I would say that the investment costs are really low. If you even want to start a new venture, the rent itself is like an investment, which you have no idea when you are going to start making, profits or even break even for that matter. If you're working from home, the costs are almost one-fourth initial costs, because you have orders prior on hand, you know how much you're going to make, procure ingredients accordingly. You don't have to keep inventory ready. You don't lose on your product's shelf life because it's just lying there and you didn't have walk-in customers today if you have a restaurant or a cafe vis-a-vis, So second is that. Also, I think the working hours are a little flexible. So this goes around both ways. One is you might end up taking a lot of time for something you didn't expect to. So it gives you a little more, gap to, prepare that way, that I might just wake up at 6, even if the order is at night, I would just wake up at 6 and make sure that everything is in place. Because even if it's not, you can manage it out of your home. That's not an issue. So that is there. Most important is, and I think this remains constant, is quality control. The kind of quality that you can deliver from home is unbeatable. It cannot be paralleled, because quality checks are, everything is just in front of your eyes. Nobody is going to do anything. You can throw it out. You see something, you just throw it out. You can't trust your staff or your, people working for you to have that kind of dedication that you have as a one-woman army, or like somebody working under you or something like that. So that. Also, I think it's really personalized and accessible also. This kind of a functional model really helps you to be in touch with clients in a way that a normal bookie wouldn't. So they can approach you at any time. They can, talk to you very in a very friendly manner. You're accessible. So they just come to you and tell you, okay, oh, you're doing it this way, but this is how I need it. So you are in a position to cater to it, and you have enough time on your hand. You have enough resources to make sure that request is catered to, because you have that 100% personal attention and involvement in that business. So I think that's about the advantages that I can think of right now. I'd like Arusha to continue.
So I agree what Mansi said. Like, firstly, you have very flexible working hours.
Yeah.
Because it's your house and you can, just work anytime and any day. So, like, considering lockdown, so my workplace is like, my basement is converted into a professional like bakery place. So it's like, I don't have to run around, or I don't have to go here or there. Even like, especially for quarantine, I can do all my preparation in my basement. And as she mentioned, like customers, we can like we can just think about it as a customer. If we go to a some professional place, like in terms of center court, you might you will not have like enough. You won't be enough comfortable enough to keep your things that you need this or you need that or you want things in that way. So it's like for a home baker, you have a comfort zone where you can give your own things that you required for no matter if it's dessert or it's a cake. I'm sure because they have their own requirement at a time and here comes your personal touch. So it's you who is doing it and people can actually see it is done by you. And I think I have had an experience when once or twice I had my helper done few things and I had people who can come to me and say me like there was something the yeah it's not the same. So yeah. I think people they themselves get to know it's you who is doing it or someone else who is doing it and probably they are coming back to you because they know who is doing it and how it is being done. And taking this quarantine into the consideration, I feel being a homemaker, it's going to be advantage, like because people anyway they know ki ghar se aa raha hai.
They have that trust.
Yeah, they have that trust ki ye ghar se aa raha hai, and people would rather come to you and compromise on, you know, like options rather than going out and getting something which they are not sure of. I mean, that's a very big advantage. And even for like initial days when you have no clue how it is going to be, you have your parents, anyone, everyone who's at home at present working and helping you out in your disasters and everything, like they are always there. You have their hand to hold if you go somewhere wrong. And I feel it's probably the good thing rather than, you know, you going to a consultant and he giving you a master plan that you have to do this, this, this. I think you are not learning anything. But once you do it, as the flow is going on and you know what you are doing is very much good and you learn things as per
And it I think it also adds immensely to your confidence, you know, the confidence.
Yeah, exactly.
Yes.
And doing it by your own self really matters a lot.
You know, like this is done in a correct way. You don't have to like think agar khane ke baad kya feedback aayega. Somewhere or the other you're confident enough ki na you have done it how it has to be. So yeah.
And it gives a personal touch. The customer have a trust and faith that being an owner, she is doing everything on her own. So that gives a trust in our clients as well. And being a home baker, it is definitely beneficial for every home baker that we have a low investment and we can contact our clients directly. And there are all perks. But I would say that having a home baking product is beneficial for clients as well because we have our own personal touch and we take care each and everything personally, which is why that everyone is trusting us rather than having that bulk production bakery product. And the second thing is that when we have a I would share one experience of my this pandemic client, and she was a new client and she was asking for hygiene and everything. And when I said that I personally do everything and I personally take care of each and every product and every baking thing and every tools and everything, and then she was like, when you are doing everything on your own, I trust you completely. It doesn't matter if I am ordering from you for the first time, but if you are doing on your own, I really liked it and I totally trust you for that. So this is how it shows trust. And how and baking and the food product is something they won't know how good we are selling until they try it. So I would say that this personal touch give us the opportunity to, you know, attract new clients.
Totally.
Absolutely. Thank you, Komal. Now moving to the most important question, I think, the webinar is. As easy as it sounds and as lucrative as it looks, you know, I think many people will get attracted and want to jump on the bandwagon and start their own ventures from home. But based on your own experiences, and I think you have been very honest, all three of you have been honest and truthful in terms of your opinion and your advices that you are giving. Would you like to share any of your challenges that any new person or professional would face in starting a new business venture or a baking from home exercise? So what are the challenges that you would normally want to ask?
I would like to start with this. I live in Adajan area, and I have a perception in my mind that this Adajan people, they don't spend much money on cakes, and they would like to have a cheaper product. But then when I started with my baking and everything, I realized that if you sell good quality products and a good product, they are ready to spend their money. And when they trust you, it's like they completely and blindly trust you. And I would say that I would suggest, and I would say that we all bakers, the thing we do is we only concentrate on our quality and the creativity. That is why we are doing better than the bulk products and bulk bakery products, because we take care. Yes,
I think to what you are saying, I think all of us have faced this. And coming to a self-realization, I have given it a lot of thought, because I have my own friends comparing my products and prices with other bakers, yeah. Or, you know, even my baker friends also, like, you know, why are you selling it at this rate? Why is the other person selling at this rate? But what you need to understand is you can never undervalue your talent. One.
Exactly.
You can, if you don't value it, there's nobody else. People want cheap products. That is the bottom line. They don't want to overspend. But somebody who understands quality, somebody who understands how much you know, work it goes into designing everything from scratch, doing it on yourself. I still have just one helper after 2 years also, because it's very difficult to trust somebody to, you know, with your product that you're going to give to your client. So I always tell them that, you know, if you've decided, like, work on a model. If you've decided your model is bulk production and lower prices, then stick to it.
Yeah.
Don't try to compare it with the other product that, oh, I'm giving a cheesecake in 300 rupees, I'll give everything in it. That is not possible. You are going to end up with losses. You're going to, or else you're going to just degrade your quality. That is the bottom line. You have to decide what is more important to you. If your quality is important, you stick to it. If you're, you know, your craft matters. So
yeah, exactly.
If you eat that, I can challenge, if you eat that 500 rupee cake and if you eat that 1500 rupees cake, there's going to be a massive difference, because everything that is used.
Add on to Mansi, like taking a basic example of chocolate. Like, people want good taste, but they forget, like, to be like giving example with names is like, if you make a cake with a modern chocolate ganache and you take a taste of Calibou, people would like Calibou, but they are not ready to pay for it. I think somewhere or the other people are lagging the knowledge, like, bahar to aisa mil raha hai, to aap kyun aisa nahi de rahe ho? But then they don't actually see the facts. Like, we just can't go and tell them ki ha hum ye chocolate use karte hain, wo chocolate use karte hain. It's just that we need to have our own value, because this happens a lot, even in my case for desserts. Like, people are going and everyone, they usually have no clue. They ate the same dessert, but they don't know what the name is. And then if you're charging them, like, no matter if they have it, they have had it in Mumbai, if you're charging like even less than that, they'll still feel, arre nahi, ye to bahut zyada hai. Still, but they forget.
Like, they wouldn't mind paying, I think, 1500 rupees for like two portions of dessert. But when it comes to local bakers, they have that, you know, they're like, ye to ghar se kar rahe hai na, cost kya hai, let them just do. They try to push you that, you know.
Yeah, I mean, giving people information and giving knowledge that they should have is like way too much difficult than what we think is like, hum logo ko ye de sakte hain, wo de sakte hain. But it depends. Like, people who know, they know. If they don't know, then they'll be just on your head dancing, no, this is not how it is. And like, it gets very much difficult to convince them.
But I think it's becoming better.
Yeah,
no?
It's becoming better. Yeah.
Yes. And there are many customers, they are still asking for discounts, that it's a Valentine, it's Diwali, what discount would you give? And I always say no, because what we are selling is something very quality product, and I'm not saying that we are losing a high rate product, but if we are selling a good quality product, then we won't compromise on prices. And eventually they will, when they taste our product, they will come to know that why we are charging high than the bakeries.
Surely. I think the difference between baking from home versus mass baking, or, you know, the companies who do it, is, I think, you know, foremost is the quality, I think, which you are able to do. Second, you have mentioned is customizing, you know, the changes that you're able to incorporate in your designs, in your taste, in your flavors and all those things based on the clients and the customer requirements. And lastly is, of course, you know, your own personal hands, your own personal techniques, your own personal expertise that you all are good at, able to bring in. And it's very much a reflection of you. And that's why I also feel, you know, like Chef Mansi was saying, you know, she's not able to trust other people and bring more hands to help her. And, you know, and that is one, you know, one area as an entrepreneur where you will feel challenged.
Yeah.
All entrepreneurs also face a challenge to scale it up. You know, feel that you have really hit the maximum point in the market, and you know you'll feel yourself that there's a need to expand and, you know, grow bigger and all that stuff. Having the right type of people, standardizing recipes would probably help, which I'm sure you are also doing being right now. But then working with people is a little more different, and that is the benefit of definitely smaller venture or baking from home, and you know you can have a private attention given to your business. Moving on to the next section, I would also want to bring your attention to this. How would you, I am sure you all are very active on the social media, probably on Facebook and Instagram and various other avenues also. So how do you leverage that? And I'm sure you, I have been following you and I keep looking at your creations and your pictures of your dishes and everything that you do. So how do you leverage the social media as an advantage for your business, for your ventures in this new age? Is your comments.
Harusha, would you like to start?
Yes. Okay. So initially when I started, it was like, for me, desserts is something that I know all age groups, they prefer, but then stepping into a dessert where you are serving like new desserts like tiramisu, macaroons, people of our generation would prefer rather than people who are older. So I had to choose like social media as my first start. Not even, not just you are making any and everything you would post it, you need to make it look creative. So I even had to get food photography done. So you know, I have people who are looking into the pictures, and then I even had to give descriptions about what I am serving and how it is done. And you know, just as a example, I would give this baked yogurt, which is Bengali, some sweet, which is similar to that. So you know, when I posted that picture, Misty Do, so I had to like give examples so all the age group could understand like what it is, how similar it would be. And it's just that it's like playing with international fusion flavors with Misty Do. Like I would add blueberry or hazelnut or coffee to it. And somewhere you need to do it on social media, because people, especially when during this lockdown, everyone is on phone. So you can reach to as many people as you can, be it on Facebook, be it on Instagram. First thing they do is open up the food, like open up the Instagram or Facebook. So you scroll down and people are like, I'm sure people are tempting, craving desserts nowadays. So all you have to do is keep boosting and keep updating them. It's not like that you have created once and you just stop. You need to keep updating or keep, you know, keep a eye that you are pitching something or the other into the market. For example, if I have like mango season is going on, so I would come up with something which is just specifically with mangoes, like mango
like tart, a mango menu, right.
Yeah, mango, like seasonal menu. So yeah, even like that has to have a constant hammering, like I post every 2 days or you know every day, so people, they have a clue that something is going on with season. So this is like social media is a add-on advantage, which is like you can't just deny, like it has to be there. It is playing a very important role nowadays, where people are seeing and you can pay and promote by your own self. You don't even need to hire someone else, because now things are so self-explained that you don't even have to go to someone else and say ki, how do I go ahead. It's like very much simple and simple to how you can promote by paying on Facebook or Instagram, where you can reach people and you can choose your own market area. Like you have to cater to Surat people, and even in Surat, what age group you would like to cater to. So it's a like win-win situation.
I think I would like to So just building up on what Arusha has said, I initially I learned it the hard way. You know, I would not post. My friends would push me that, you know, please post, please keep on posting. But
same happened with me.
Yeah, when you same. Work, you do not have the time to edit everything, make sure everything is right, and because you can't post random content, right? You have to make sure that it's in line with what you want your product to look like, what you want your venture to look like. So that's why there was a period where I didn't give it enough importance. But I've learned it the hard way that I'm going to have my customers, like the customers are already coming to me, the retention is 100%. But if I don't post, it's not going to go forward. You're going to be stagnant. You're going to hit that point where somebody who's, it's very obvious. Instagram also started, when Instagram started, you would see that it was bombarded and it was full of food posts, right? And if you think of Instagram, it's more like 80% food, and other than that, some makeup, hacks, this, that, right? Instagram is a platform like that. So where it gives all these talents some space to talk about, to keep posting. So I think that is really, really important. And you need to keep it engaging. You need to involve more people into your pages. Like, you know, you involve them like in a way that this is our maybe 1,000th customer. So you keep some challenges for them. You do something like that. I'm not just saying give out free things, but you do need something to keep them engaged so that they remember. Because right now it's all about...
Even to share your knowledge, you can, you know, just come up with desserts and say, make a guess. I mean,
even I had a similar mistake that as everyone knows that I'm not a social person and I was not on a social media. That actually was a very hard time for me. And when I started have my Facebook page and my Instagram page, and when other clients recommend us, and I got a good footfall from that, and then I realized that I had a big mistake, but that is how learning happens, right? So that is how I learned, and that is how I understand that having a food, even you have a food product, apart from taste, appealing, how it is appealing and how it looks is also important. So when we have a pictures on Facebook and Instagram, it actually boosts our business. Really, and it is a very low of cost. I mean, if we don't have, if we don't even boost, we have enough clientele from other clients that you know we can have a good customers, and it is a very low cost. I mean, it is way more better than having a word mouth publicity.
It's a very simple thing, like you know, people eat with their eyes first.
Yeah,
so surely. Thank you so much. I think you really have created a lot of interest in all of us and for the participants also. I think we are also running short of time.
Yeah.
So I think it will also be a good thing because I promised to the audience earlier that we'll be sharing some of your creations and your pictures. Can I take the attention to the presentation? Can I draw your attention there?
Sure. Yeah, sure.
Okay. So just give me a minute. I will share the screen. I think you can all see this. So I will just run the presentation.
Yeah. Arusha.
I think it's now functional. So I think we are starting with Chef Arusha's creations. Let's whisk. So Arusha, would you like to speak anything about your work, about your creations?
Yeah. So like in first picture, it's a dessert table. Where you, I know it's not a big thing in India, but I have seen like people just going crazy about it, where you have dessert table, you have different desserts on the table. So in my case, this is a basic picture that I show, and then I can customize according to the customers. Like I have, you can see macaroons. Nilsa, can we go to that slide?
So sure.
Previous one.
Sorry, yes. This one?
No.
This one?
No. First one.
Sorry, I missed that.
Yeah, this one. So here it's like a basic table where you have options of desserts, where, you know, it's a... it's a one-stop place where you can have any dessert. So if someone is like keen on having other few small, like there is a mocktail glasses and everything, which is just new to the people. Still, people are accepting it. But every time someone or the other who I'm talking to with this is like keen on knowing and, you know, working on things like this. So you just don't have one thing on the table and you have different things on the table. So they can pick and choose the desserts they want. And usually people go with donuts and macaroons, and which is like people, kids always want, which is like more of colorful things, cakesicle, popsicle, no matter what it is. And then in next slide, I have. So yeah, one is like mango tartlets, which comes like seasonally, and it's a thing like it is not understood by everyone, each and everyone. I would share an experience when I have seen people buying it and they just scoop everything out, eat it and throw the tart. I had to like go to people and go to them and say like this has to consume like this. And then it's like these products are something people prefer who can, you know, understand what it is, or they'll just
already have that knowledge or have traveled.
Yeah,
I think
they'll just reject it. So it gets very difficult at a point to pitch yourself that you are doing something new which no one else is doing as of now. I mean, people would come up with that later once they see potential and everything. Like copying is like happening, every other door is doing it right now. Like as a home baker, like everyone, each and everyone wants to become a home baker. And especially with cakes and desserts, they just think it's like to-do thing, like it would just happen. But they forget that there is some technicality which involves, and you can anytime, you can make a different, you know, you can see the difference, like what's happening and what's not. And this picture shows the macaroons I have, like this is what I had to get it done. It was a food photography done to picture my products. Because it is very obvious, first you see and then you eat.
Yeah.
So the second one, the third one is, this product was like I got motivated through Scoop Waffle, which has honey and everything, but then still people, it gets very difficult for us to tell people what it is. So I had to modify it where people can just take it as a snack and have it. So this was the new thing I got recently done. And the last one is tiramisu. Again, with tiramisu, people, they have mindset, someone strong coffee and someone is like, no, humko to kadwa laga. And some people, if you give less coffee, they are like, coffee ka taste nahi tha. So you always have different buds for all the products.
I think beautiful presentation and lovely creations.
Pictures, I love the pictures. Absolutely amazing. Like the last.
Yeah, with your permission, I will move to the next. Thank you so much, Chef Arusha, for sharing your creations. Now, the next, I think, in line is Chef Mansi's products that we have here. Mansi, would you like to speak?
Yeah, the reason why I put my cakes first is everybody asks that, you know, everybody can make a cake and what's so different and things like that. So first, about my cakes, I never work with fondant because I personally don't like it. I respect the art. I have a few of my friends who make amazing fondant cakes and I love them. I love to look at them, but that is not something that, what I want to do, right? So what my cakes represent is, if you see the fourth slide with the toasted oranges on top. So I try to recreate classic cakes and give out different flavors. So if you see the one with oranges, it's basically like an apricot orange pistachio cake with like a citrus punch. So if you see at the normal cake shops and all, you won't get a lot of options because this is not profitable to a lot of people, right? Not everybody is going to come and opt for an apricot cake. But I want to introduce these flavors because people don't know only until they've eaten. They don't know what everything tastes like. If I've got the, you know, eye that this can taste better, I would like to introduce it to my clients. So this actually is my USP. My flavors are the most questionable ones. People would be like, why are you putting this and this together? But that is something that keeps me going. I love experimenting with flavors. And this is like an example for it. If we move to the next slide. So
So I myself am really into fitness solely because not to get thin or anything, but everybody needs to be fit to, you know, have a lifestyle. And if you see in Surat with the increasing level of fitness, people demand cakes that are, you know, vegan, gluten-free, sugar-free, and you can't completely avoid that market. So I tried to tap on that market. If you see the cake on the left, that cake does not contain any gluten. It doesn't have sugar. It doesn't, but it still is one of our best-seller cakes. The second picture that you see, it's actually a dessert that I've created. It has, it's a vegan dessert. It has a Fayutini crunch on the bottom. It has a milk, like a soy milk mousse ganache on the top. And these are some of the variants that are very popular amongst our menu. And people do demand for this because this is something that you won't get in your normal, you know, places that offer a lot of desserts. So it's places you go and eat out to. When I started, I think none of the, maybe one or two of the home bakers were doing bread. This is like really close to my heart. These are focaccia sliders. People, if you see the focaccia that is available in the normal shops, they are just bread. They don't have anything classic about them. That's not how a real focaccia is supposed to be. And I really love it. So I tried to introduce this and it was unbelievable. The kind of response that I got to this is still unbelievable. This is my most, you know, this is my top selling bread as of now. Like, I haven't received one negative criticism for this one as yet. And yeah, the next slide. So we're also into cupcakes because these are the you know, fastest things that get picked up. If you want to eat something less but sweet, a cupcake is the way to go. And mini cupcakes are like handy. You can keep it for your, and it really caters to a very big market because you have a lot of ventures. Now the culture of Surat is like people want to open up stores and they have such launches, soft launches, and desserts are always a part of it. So you can never go wrong with this. So this is one of the ventures that we did for a jewelry store. This one is for a co-working space that we did. So yeah, that's about Aman. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you so much, Mansi. I would just keep my comments towards the end. So I'm just waiting for Chef Komal also Komal to do her presentation. And I think she has a stunning piece of work.
From the beginning, I was very clear that I wanted to create something really creative with the cake, and I would like to play with the forms and then everything. And well, I think that when you want to have some, when you have a sweet craving, why to compromise on sugar or anything? If you want to have it. Don't compromise.
Yeah,
or yes, just indulge in it. So I took. It took a lot of time to learn this kind of a cake, and it needs a wooden structure for each and every cake. And it took, I would say that to create this cake, it take 2 days to create this cake. And these two cakes are very close to my heart, this one and the next one. And and I was not sure if Surat people would like to have this kind of cake, and you know, they are if they are ready to spend it or not. But when they see the pictures of this cake, they are actually ready to spend it, as well as they are very excited about the cake. And I always wanted to have something different than other bakers, so this is what I choose to have my USP. And this makes my product standing different in the crowd.
Absolutely. Thank you so much, everyone. I think, you know, I mean, all of your products are very, very progressive, forward, and I think very contemporary. And I think, you know, all the sliders, the cakes, the flavor profiles, all really, I mean, represent the youth that you all are also part of. And these are very, very modern, robust flavors, I think, which will also become more popular. And as you have been saying and calling for, that people, the acceptance will also increase as time goes on. I think we are running short of time, so I think we will move quickly to take a few questions, because there have been a lot of questions, as you may be seeing. coming this way. So I would now request my colleague Chef Jignesh to please take over some few questions and put it to the panelists. Thank you. Over to you, Chef.
Dear panelists, it's been a very insightful conversation, right? And I think all the attendees have been enjoying and really learning a lot from your experiences which you have shared. I would just like to ask you questions which they have brought up. Do you think, you know, coming back to the comment which Chef Arusha made, that, you know, using, when in terms of using a chocolate ganache, when you do it with a morde and when you do it with a calamari, there's a lot of difference in terms of taste profile, and people ask as to, you know, how, why do I pay so much or why do I pay less? So do you believe, do you, all of three of you believe that, you know, educating customers is a need of an art?
Absolutely.
Yeah.
Absolutely. Yeah. We need to know the difference between what they're demanding and what they're expecting. I mean, at least you need to know what you're asking for. You can't, if you're aware, you won't make that thing only, like, you know, you won't make that kind of a demand only in the first place. If you're well aware about the situation.
I had one customer who wanted a cake with lint. It has to be lint. And she herself said, I know it's going to be expensive, but I like your cake. So I had to explain her how my cake is done. But if she still wants to add lint thing to it, then she was herself ready to know how, what is the value for it and how much it is going to be. So she is like not cribbing or crying. No, this has to come in this budget only. I'm ready to pay how much ever it is, because I think there are customers who know how much it is.
I know. I think I have to give credit to some of my customers who do know what they're asking for. If they know that they're asking for a blueberry cake, and if I tell them that I'm not using a preservative, I'm not using like a ready syrup, I'm using fresh berries, so they understand that a simple small box is going to be costing me 450 to 500 rupees.
Even that happens with Ferrero Rocher cake as well. They know that how it costs, but even though they wanted to have a cheaper one, but it is not possible when we use a pure Ferrero Rocher chocolate. It is going to be a costly.
But there are customers who know what they are demanding and they are ready to pay for it.
Yes. Absolutely. Yeah.
Right. So true. So true. We would also like to know, you know, if anybody who wants to start their venture, like start being a home baker, you know, what are the basic equipments would you suggest? And is it compulsory to have an expensive oven? Because first thing comes, you know, when it comes to baking, oven plays a very important role.
I think it does play important role when you come to a dessert. I'm sure not with cake, because you know, because cake is something basic. But like if you go in terms of dessert, so if you are baking a macaroon, so sometimes you need to have a fan on in your oven, and sometimes for some desserts you don't need fans on. If you have to make an eclair, so you don't need a fan on. But then you need to open your duct to get the moisture out. So there are
steam.
Oven plays an important role, but then you need to know what is on your menu.
Yeah. I think initially you do not require a very expensive oven, because you also don't have that kind of a knowledge to, you know, directly jump into something and get a big thing. Like, you know, for breads and all, you might require a specified oven, like a specialized oven and a proofer. But other than that, I think for basics, you do not require an expensive oven. Like a normal Morphy Richards or something is very good, and it's something that even we use. OTG is fine.
Even I have seen some bakers who are using that stove for baking cakes, and I mean, if you really don't have oven and you don't want to spend, you can use the stove as well, because they are having that salt platter on it and they baked the cake and it was actually good one. And I would say that apart from oven, air condition is very important and playing a major role in creating cake, because we use non-dairy whipping cream, and that actually required a cool temperature when we whip it or when we are using it. Otherwise, it loses its consistency and it won't look attractive when we put it on the cake.
That's very insightful. One more question I wanted to ask is, you know, what is the major challenge you face when it comes directly or indirectly competing with the most established brand, even in a niche segment? Because if you say in brands, the established ones are also available in across all the segments. right? So what is the biggest challenge which you as a home baker needs to work on?
I would like to go ahead with this first, because I still get a lot of calls on a day-to-day basis that, oh, do you have anything ready? Or do you have anything on the rack?
Yes.
Like, you know, yeah, do you have something prepared? But the challenge is to explain it to them that this is how we are different. Like, we do not keep things made and just store it. We make things on order. It's according to your requests. That is how we work. That is our business model. Whereas they are, it's not like they're wrong or anything. That's a perfectly different business model. It's working and it has a lot of people. It is a bigger model. So they have things ready and it's readily available. They have that advantage in that, you know, if I want a cake at 11 in the night, there is a store I can go to, but you can't go to a home bakery for that.
I would like to add saying, but in my case also, I at a point where I was doing good with my business, but I was somewhere lagging. I somewhere knew that I need to have a display to show people how exactly a dessert looked like. So yeah. I had to get my photo shoot done like from a professional, because if I say someone, this is a tart, so I need to explain them what is a tart, how does it look like. So just me saying tart, it won't make them understand how it is going to be. So I thought initially I need a display, like display to see if the desserts, like, you might not know what this dessert is, but if it seems attractive, you would just go and give it a chance. You would just go and buy once. So I think somewhere this is also one point where we lag, because we can't have a display and customer walking in.
Yes.
We are making it personalized and we are just more into what customer wants rather than what we want customer to eat. So it plays a very important role. Like,
I would like to add on this that what makes us different is that we have a fresh product. I mean, they have a cold storage cake, and it was like, I have seen some local brands which are very famous and they have cake stored for at least 6 months and they don't have enough live shelves. But the what we sell have a good live shelf as well. So and it is more healthier because we baked fresh when they order, when they made order, then only we bake for them. It's not ready made, so it is way more healthier and good for health. And even when we have this kind of a situation, when we are in a pandemic situation, so what is more good to have a fresh food rather than having a cold storage food?
That's thank you. Nice, actually.
Chef, just a minute, just before you take the last question, I think we just have time for one more question. But before you take, request all the participants, there is a document uploaded on chat. Please fill it up. I think it will just be there for the next 5 more minutes. And this is all the people who fill that form will be getting the certificate at the end of this webinar session. Thank you so much, everyone. Yes, Chef, over to you, please.
Yes, I have one last question to ask, you know. What are your favorite flavor combinations? What are your signature items which you would like to share with it?
Well, my signature flavor is chocolate and orange combination. People are loving it. Like, I was not expecting that they are going to love that much, but they like to have chocolate and citrus flavor together. And it actually, people come to me and asking for the same flavor that you wanted to have, that your chocolate and orange combination flavor. So I felt that there are people of group who like to try new products or who like to try new taste and who like to have experiments with their food products. And so I would say that people, if we have a good example, or we can, you know, on the spot, we can give them an example that how it will taste. It gives enhancement to, you know, their taste, and if they try, they will know it, what they are going to have it in their cake. So that is a beneficial.
I think with flavors, Chef, it's like, if we play with some new flavors, it's like either people are going to accept it or they're just going to reject it. There is no mediocre thing happening ki haan, theek hai. Because I've seen matcha is something which is booming internationally, but I don't really see anyone accepting matcha, at least in Surat. Yes. And then even if it comes to my desserts, then I could always play with flavors in my macarons. So bubblegum was something which people accepted. And then I had pan. people did accept it, but people who did not, they were like, disgusting, this is what, but people who loved it, they just loved it. Like, they came back specially, and I had to tell them, I'm not making it like bulk, you need to order it specially. And there were people who were ready to pay for flavors, you are just playing around, and there are people who will just bash you for trying new flavors. So either it's win-win or you just are gone with the new flavors at least.
Right. I just like to repeat that question for Chef Mansi, you know, which is asking as to what is your favorite flavor combination and your signature recipes, or basically your dessert or the product which you like to share with everyone.
Okay, so flavors are extremely personal. I think if you talk about me, for me, like a classic passion fruit flavored. You know, a macaron or like a passion fruit flavored entremet is something which is my all-time favorite. It's something that we don't get it in Surat. Even if I want to make it, I have to source it from Mumbai, and I make it like on very few occasions. Hello, am I audible?
Yes.
Okay, so I think that's my classic, like most favorite. And for the like for my clients, I think sea salt, dark chocolate, and coffee. That's the icing, and vanilla half and half. That's my most running flavor as of now.
And there are some group of clients where they would like to have a combination of Indian flavors like gulab jamun, rasgulla with the cake. And
even rasmalai.
Yeah, people are liking that kind of flavors. Yeah. Yes.
Yeah, I think Indian also had a phase in baking. It was a phase.
Think that for occasions, like especially Janmashtami, Diwalis and stuff like that, people prefer more like Indian flavor infused.
Yes.
Like they want those flavors during that time.
Right. Thank you very much for answering all the questions and actually enlightening all the attendees about different format, because I would say this discussion actually helped everybody to even understand, get a real life pulse about the situation which has been happening. Is actually coming from the source, which three of you are actually dealing with situations on a day-to-day basis, and that is where I believe that this particular through this session, everybody has actually understood what is home baking like, what are the realities, what are the ups and downs of that particular life which an home baker lives through, right? And what challenges people face, and then how do you even overcome that challenge? Because it becomes really difficult or disheartening when a sudden big bomb puts on you in terms of a challenge, and then you're not able to make it up, or as you shared, the recipe is done, doesn't work out, you have an order pending to go, right? So I believe your conversations, which are very open and transparent, which I believe it boosts lots of confidence for the people, upcoming home bakers. So I would personally really like to thank all three of you for giving out the time and sharing your wonderful experience with all of us. Thank you so much.
It's our pleasure, Chef. And a very happy birthday to Vimal sir. He has taken out time on his birthday to do this. So, I don't know if he's there.
Yes, wish you a very happy birthday, Vimal sir. Sir, you are muted.
He's not audible. Yeah.
Chef Mansi, Chef Arusha, and Chef Komal, and Chef Jignesh also. I think it's been a really interesting and very, very enriching session for all the participants. And I think people have been. It's given them a new hope, it's given them a new avenue, a new career option. And I think you really have simplified it and put it in a very, very easy manner for them. Thank you so much for your sharing your experiences and your first cake experiences. Thank you so much. You really have been really honest and pure. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
I would also like to thank my members from the Oro University, my IT team, Mr. Manishi, Ms. Shreya Mathur, and Mrs. Pinal, from the registrar's office, and especially all the attendees for attending this webinar and being part of this and giving us your valuable participation. Thank you so much all. We hope to see you again sometime in the future.
Okay. For sure.
If you want to do a second part to this webinar. Thank you so much.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you so much. Thank you. Bye.
Bye.